Good morning, everyone. Today I am going to show you how I make my beautiful meatballs. I had a picture up the other day on Facebook. And by the way, if you guys want to follow me on Facebook, I go under Connie's RAWsome Kitchen. My personal, unfortunately, you can't add me anymore. I'm at the limit there. So if you want to follow me, you can follow me on Connie's RAWsome Kitchen on Facebook. And that's where I'm going to be putting up the giveaways. So if you're interested in receiving some giveaways, I'm going to start off with some small stuff. But hopefully I'm going to have some nice blenders. So yes, just follow me on Connie's RAWsome Kitchen. And you'll get some extra information there that I won't have on YouTube. So yes, that's where I posted my my meatball pictures. So here we go. And we're going to start off with 1 cup of gluten. But I do have that espresso cup in there where I'm going to use to measure my gluten out on. So I'm going to need 1 cup. And just maybe a little more to get it to the top. And that's about it, I think. Yeah. So, 1 cup gluten, and this is the vital wheat gluten. We're gonna need, here's my beautiful mushroom powder I make, and I told you how I make this. I basically buy some dried Asian mushrooms at the Asian store. That's where I get the best price on these mushrooms. And I buy a whole bunch of them and keep them in the pantry. So when I need them, I just take them. And I just blend them up in a blender till they turn into a nice powder. And it is like a powder. It's very, very fine dust. So I need 1 tablespoon of that. We're going to need some chickpea flour. And remember, a lot of people ask me why I put chickpea flour or other type of non-gluten flour. It's because it actually tenderizes the meat. So I'm going to use 2 of this. Sorry about the shaky. There we go. Now I have nutmeg, and I usually put 2 nice pinches. So 2 nice pinches is basically about here, and I'm going to show you. So 2 nice pinches of nutmeg is about, it's the nutmeg I'm using. It's about 1/4 teaspoon of nutmeg. So I'm using 2 large pinches or 1/4 teaspoon. Same thing with cloves. We're going to take 1/4 teaspoon of cloves. There we go. And we're going to need also about 1/4 teaspoon of sage. There we go. We need some salt. Now I don't like to make my meatballs too salty. Jeez, that's about 1/2 teaspoon. 1/2 teaspoon of salt. Because the sauce is going to have salt in it. And if you're putting some mozzarella on top of your meatballs, if you're making like the subs that I made for dinner, that's going to have some salt in it. So you want to ease up on the salt. You could always shake some salt on your plate if you need to. Sorry. Okay, so we have 2 pinches of sage, the cloves, the nutmeg. And now we're going to put some of my Caribbean spice. Why? Well, because my husband loves this stuff in his meat. So I'm just going to put 1 tablespoon of Caribbean spice. Now, if you don't have Caribbean spice, I guess you could use maybe Italian herb mix or whatever spices that you like. You could even make them Greek if you want, if you have some Greek seasoning. So since my husband likes the Caribbean, that's what I'm putting in there. We also need some TBP. Now, I'm not sure if you know what TBP is. Basically, it's some textured protein. Now, I picked this up at the bulk barn, but I'm sure you could get this at the health store now. And this is what it looks like. And that just kind of adds a little extra bits into the meat. You don't have to put this, but I do. This is the way I make my meatballs, so I'm just going to keep following my recipe. So I am going to use 1/3 cup of this, which is not much, but for some reason I always put it in my meatballs, and that's what I'm gonna do again. I'm just gonna put it back in there. I'm gonna have to try making some without it, but for now, here we go. I'm trying to be clean as I'm making this video, which is really crazy on my part. Okay, so we mix this up, and I'm gonna also add to this. Where is it? Here it is. Now, remember that milk powder I told you? This is soy milk powder. It's not soy protein. Mind you, it could be the same thing. I'm not sure. But I know that I have soy protein that I buy, and this is soy milk powder. This is that milk that I put in my meat recipe. I did this by accident, and it came out so nice and tender, so I'm still using it. But I'm not going to make a batch of milk. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to throw in the powder and then add the water, rather than make my big batch of milk, because I'm not sure when I'm going to make my next batch of meat, so I don't want it to go wasted. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to take the powder, and I'm going to use a half cup of this. Here we go. Yeah, I'm going to use a half cup of this. Here we go. And I'm going to add it straight to my mixture. And now we're going to put my panko. And I'm going to need a 1/3 cup of panko. And that is panko, if anyone is not sure what panko is. It's basically Japanese breadcrumbs. And it's just a more crunchier, thicker piece of bread, rather than the Italian breadcrumbs, which is more fine. So this is what I'm using, and I'm using 1/3 cup of this. And we want to mix this up really good. So now this is my base. And we're going to put this aside. Here we go. I'm going to put this aside, and I'm going to show you what I'm going to put in my food processor. There we go. We're going to take one large, that's a pretty large portobello. It fits like that in my hand, and it's pretty thick. So I'm going to use one of these, and I put everything, even the gills in it. Even the butt end, believe it or not. I make, actually, one day I'm going to have to show you, I make meat out of the butt ends of my mushrooms. Okay, so we're just going to give this a fast pulse. And we don't want this over processed. We want it that it has little bits, but you don't want it too big either, because then it's just going to slide out of your meatball. We have one or two that didn't quite make it, but we'll just break it up. So this is what it looks like. And we're going to dump this right into our dry ingredients. There we go. And we're not going to mix it yet. Or you could if you want to. But right now we need to add a couple of more ingredients, and that's going to be half an onion. Okay, so here we go. We're just going, oh, let me put this back in. We're just going to put half an onion. There we go. And a whole lot of parsley. Now, I usually use about, that's right, I use about half a cup of parsley. But I'm not going to put the stems, because the stems are a little hard to break down in my food processor. Not the best. I mean, it's not a bad food processor, but it's not the best. I'm just going to use the tender parts. I'm not going to use these stems. Oop, sorry about that. But I am going to use the leaves of the parsley, or the tender stems of the parsley. And it's going to be about half a cup. So you want a nice bunch. And I mean, I'm eyeballing it, but if you're not sure, just put it in separate and then pulse it. And if you need more, you'll just add more to pulse. But you do need about a half a cup of parsley, which is a pretty nice bunch of parsley that's going to go into this recipe. Now, you could use the dry stuff, but I've never used the dry stuff in this one. So I can't tell you exactly how much you use, but really, I would say maybe a good teaspoon or two of dry parsley if you don't have the fresh one. And parsley is so good, especially in meatballs. So if it's a little extra, it really isn't the end of the world. It just adds more flavor. So I took about a good half bunch of parsley, and we're going to chop that up with the onion, and then we're going to add it to the dry mixture. We might need even more. There's nothing like fresh herbs from the garden. It's just amazing. The taste and the smell of the herbs are so much more pungent and strong. It really is something else. Plus, it has a lot more benefits than the stuff that you buy that comes from a greenhouse. Okay, so let's give this a fast go. And if I need more parsley, I'll just chop it up. Yeah, as you see, there's still some stems that didn't quite make it. But you could always pull those out. So I'm just going to pulse this a little more. And here we go. We're going to add this to my bowl. I mean, I could have used a little more parsley, but we'll see. Basically, you need about a nice half bunch of parsley into your mixture. Okay, so we're going to take some garlic. Let me put this away. And we're going to crush garlic right into the bowl. And I would say about two nice cloves of garlic. And if you like it really garlicky, well, just go ahead and add more garlic. But I'm only going to put two in this. There we go. I'm only going to use two. Because my Caribbean spice, believe it or not, has garlic in it. So I'm only going to use two cloves. And that just adds a little extra bite when you bite into your meatball. My favorite, I mean, I shouldn't complain, but my favorite garlic press broke, and I bought this one to replace, and this wasn't cheap either, and I bought this one to replace it, and it really is a pain in the butt. Sorry, didn't mean to say it, but it really is. Okay, so here we go, and here I go. I'm just going to mix this lightly. I want to mix this now before I add any liquids to this. I want to make sure that it's just evenly mixed around. And here's a big piece of mushroom that I'm just going to chop up a little. And I find that the larger the mushroom is, especially the portobello, that skin is like leather on top. So you want to chop it up really good. Okay, so I've got everything in there. Now we're going to start with the liquid. Now, we could either mix it in a container, which I am. I just want to remove these stems. And I don't throw these stems away because you could use this either in a broth. I just throw it in a freezer and then I put it in broth or whatever else I'm going to use it for. So I'm just going to push this away. Okay, so we're going to need only a half a cup of water, and then we're gonna play it by ear. If we need more, we will add, because sometimes my mushroom's a little bigger, or my measuring of my flour could be a little extra than I normally put, because I'm never precise. I never take that knife or spoon and just cut off everything on top. I just kind of grab my stuff and I throw it in. So I could always be off a little with the flour. So it's always best to add less in the beginning, and then if you need it, well, then you add more. So I'm going to use a half a cup of water. Now you could either measure it, or you could go straight into put it straight into your ingredients. And if I need extra water, I'm going to use extra water. Okay, so I've got half a cup of water. I'm going to need 3 tablespoons of olive oil, which I ran out of. If you give me a second, I'll go get it. And you could tell this is good olive oil. Look how green it is. 1, 2, 3. I'm going to put just a little extra, and I'll tell you why. Because sometimes the oil remains in your container. If you don't want that to happen, just add the ingredients straight into your flour mixture, and not worry if you've got the right amount. So I've got three plus a bit of olive oil, and I'm gonna put 2 tablespoons of my beautiful pesto I make. Hopefully I should have enough in this jar. Okay, so I have 1. And yeah, I'm gonna need more. Oh no, I'm good. 2. So I'm just gonna take whatever's left in there. So 2 tablespoons of pesto. You can put 3 if you want. That really is up to you. But I normally put 2 tablespoons of pesto into my mixture. And if you want the recipe on how to make my pesto, I'll put a link up for you. So here we go. We're gonna just add this all to your dry ingredients. Now, because the mushrooms and the onions are wet, you might not need extra water, but if you do, we'll just add a little bit at the end. Now, this is what I mean about all the oil stays around the cup. But I'll show you what I do to pick that up. I'm just going to clean my spoon. Now you're saying, why did you put so much oil? Why are you putting all that pesto? Why are you putting this? Well, when you make meat from meatballs from meat, meat has its own natural fats. Yes, it does. It has a lot of fats on its own, so you really don't need to add any liquids to it, because it's going to have a fatty texture to the meatball. But because gluten is fat-free, and you don't have to put it, I mean, you know, if you're worried about the oil or if you're worried about the fat, you don't have to. You don't have to put that extra oil into your recipe. But you're going to get a very dry meatball because gluten doesn't have any fat in it. So we have to add things to it to give it that moist, wet feel when you bite into it. So I do need a little extra. So I'm just going to use about maybe, let me see, about an eighth of a cup. There we go. And I'm just going to put it on the outside, where the ingredients are still dry. Here we go. So basically it's a half a cup plus 1/8 cup of water. So it's a half plus 1/8. And that should cover your, see how it just picks up all the dry ingredients that's at the bottom of my mixture. So this is pretty much done. Now, to pick up all the oil that's left here, I'm just going to take some meat and I'm just going to pick up all the rest of the olive oil that is still stuck inside my cup. There you go. And we don't waste. I do have a little bit of pesto left in this jar. I'm going to use that also because I hate wasting. You know me, I keep saying how I hate it. There we go. A little extra pesto is not going to kill anyone. It's going to make it just taste that much better. Okay, so I don't need the other. Now, in my pesto, I do put the grated cheese I make. My pesto is not just basil and oil and garlic. It also has the Parma cheese that I make. And if you want, like I said, I'll link you and you can make it. So now we're going to shake these up into decent sized meatballs. Okay. Now I use a small ice cream scooper just to kind of guide me. But you can just eyeball it. There we go. And you're going to roll these up into a decent size meatball. And if you see that one's just hanging out onto the side, take it off. Okay, so here we go. We're going to start making them. So basically, here we go. So we're going to start shaping them. And you should get quite a bit of meatballs with this batch. You don't want them too big because you're just going to get a huge ball of gluten. So, you know, the smaller they are, the nicer they actually are. You got to remember, it isn't meat where it has all that animal fat that keeps the meatball moist. And if you see a little stem of your parsley sticking out, just yank it off. So. But these are really, really good. You're going to need some extra gluten flour, so about a little espresso cup full. And we're going to roll these into that flour. Now, like I was saying, I'd like to give some giveaway to you guys. So if you follow me on my Facebook, and that's Connie's RAWsome Kitchen, I'll put a link in the description below this video, and you can go there. What I'm going to do is I'm going to do some giveaways, and I want to start off with some Indian salt. I know a lot of people are having a hard time finding that agi salt, so I want to give out some of that salt. And that salt could have gone in here too, you know that, right? Because when you make meatballs the traditional way, you would also throw in an egg. So if you want, you could also throw in some of that salt and add it to your meatball mixture. Not that it's going to make it taste like egg, but it just adds that little extra flavor that the original meatball has. These are really nice and moist. Now the idea is that we're going to have to cook these before we put them in our sauce. I mean, we could. I haven't experimented because I have different meatball recipes. This is one of my meatball recipes. I'm going to add even, there's another one I make. I'm going to make another video another time. See, there's that little stem that didn't quite get chopped up. So if you see it sticking out of your meatball, just remove it. So, like I was saying, I really do want to give some giveaways. And so follow me, and I will post it there when I am doing it. And we're going to start small and hopefully work our way up to where I can maybe, you know, give away a blender or something that you guys can use. I made these yesterday, and then I says, you know what, I have to make a video for everyone. I made these yesterday, and I made subs for dinner, and my husband, well, because he gets to eat all the food. I basically eat fruits and vegetables, but everything is raw. But if I make, like yesterday, I did have one meatball. And I know a lot of you that eat cooked are saying, you know, how can I deny myself? But I actually just feel so good when I eat that way. I have lots of energy. And I don't mind. But once you start eating cooked, all the flavors and all the spices just start overwhelming you, and you just want to continue eating that way. So that's why I try not to eat too much of it, because then, and like I said, I'm not saying that it's a bad way to eat. I'm just saying what is best for me. I know that I personally feel the best when I'm eating raw. But I still have to cook for my family. So if I make a pretty good recipe, like I want to make something that you guys, if you're Italian, you might know what it is. But over the holidays, I make, not always, but I do sometimes. My sisters and I take a turn each over the holidays. Who does Christmas? Who does Easter? Who does New Year's? So if we get cracking and busy, you know, we make, but we don't always make everything that our mother used to make. For instance, one of the things that she used to make is these raviolis. They're sweet raviolis, believe it or not. And there's a chestnut filling in it. And it's chocolate, chestnuts with booze. And then you sprinkle some powdered sugar on top. And that is something to die for. It really is good. So I want to make one of those videos to show you how we make those. And there's also stuffed olives that I make over the holidays. And it's not something that you can't have every day. Of course you can have every day. But it's such a long process, especially if you're making it for the holidays. You make so much of it that you really don't want to make too many during the year. You just wait for the holidays. But it's a holiday food, so we don't usually make it if it's not a special occasion. Either holiday or occasion. And that's my stuffed olives. And those are just so good and amazing. But you guys can just make it anytime you want. They're great as finger food. If you have people coming over. And what's good about these is you could actually make them ahead of time. And you can freeze them. The same thing with these. You could actually make these meatballs. If you're in a mood one day and you say, you know what, I'm going to make a whole bunch of meatballs. Freeze them, and then when I need to, I'm just going to take them out and cook them. You can actually do that. Or throw them in the sauce. So what you're going to do is you're going to make them, you're going to brown them, and then you're going to put them into the freezer. So you can make a whole bunch of these, and then just when you're ready and you want to make some sauce with meatballs, you just pull them out of the freezer and they're done. You don't have to worry about making the meatballs from scratch. That's the best part about, you know, cooking ahead of time. Gives you more time to either go hiking, or, you know, it depends what you're into. If you're into exercising or just going for long walks. Okay, so I'm rambling on like a crazy woman over here. Keeping you here watching me roll meatballs. I might have to cut this one short. 16, 18, we got 22 meatballs, right? Okay, so we're going to need a little plate. And we're going to put some vital wheat gluten onto the plate. Here we go. Just a little bit at a time so you don't waste it, because this stuff is expensive. And then we're just going to roll these into the flour. And put it aside. And what this does is basically helps let everything that's in there stick inside your meatball. So you're going to continue doing this. I'm not going to keep you here watching me roll these balls into this flour. But you're going to do the same thing. You're going to take each one and you're going to simply roll them into the gluten. But for now, I am going to just put them in the gluten. So I'll see you in a bit where I'm going to show you how to cook these. All right, we're just going to let them sit. I'm going to clean up my space and I'll show you how I cook them. Okay, we're just going to let the oil get hot. Now, you can use, as your sauce, you can use any marinara sauce. So there's a simple sauce you could use. You could also use the one I have up on YouTube. If you check my video on my marinara sauce recipe there. Oh no, actually my pizza sauce. There's one there if I'm not mistaken. But I'll find the recipe for you and I'll link it. But you can use any spaghetti sauce recipe that you have. And that's where you're going to throw your meatballs in. We're just going to let this heat up. Be good. We're just going to put one there for testing. We'll know when it's ready. So a lot of you are going to say, if you don't have the that milk powder I use, the soy milk powder, what can you use? Well, if you don't have that, you can use, by the way, you want this not on a high heat. You want this on a medium medium to low heat. And then we're going to really put this down to low. Let me lower it down now. If you don't have that soy milk, what can you use? What can you use? Well, then if you don't have that milk powder, what you can do is use soy milk or almond milk if you want to give it a go with that. And what you're going to do is use that in replacement of water. Do not add the water and the milk because then you're going to have a soppy mess. So if you do need to add milk because you don't have the powder, just omit the water. So here we go. We're just going to brown these up. And just move them around to get them all. You want them golden all the way around. So if you have it on a higher heat, then you're going to need to lower them down for the second step of this. Should I use a bigger pot, huh? Bigger pan. So get these going until you get them nice and golden. And if you have to add extra oil, because if you've worked with seitan, you realize that seitan, if you're frying it up in a pan, if you're working with seitan in a pan, you're going to notice it does drink up some oil. So just keep moving it around, and if you need oil, just add it. And just get them till they're a nice golden color. That's step one. I have them a little packed, so I'm just going to remove a couple. Just so we have more room for them to move in this pan. Yeah, I'm just going to remove a few. It's going to be a lot easier to cook these up. Okay. So, medium heat. And the reason is that once you've encased everything inside, you're going to get a nice crust and you won't have them breaking up in the sauce. Because you're going to keep these after we've done what we've done to them, but they're going to stay in the sauce for a while on a low heat. So don't make your sauce too thick, because these are going to go into your sauce. And they're going to absorb some of the tomato. If you're afraid of doing it that way, what you can do is just cook them completely. That means they're going to go into the oven rather than the sauce, and then add them into your, then you can add them to your sauce if you're worried that your sauce might be too thick. I personally add them when my sauce is not so thick, and it just cooks right into the sauce. So we're just gonna let them cook like this. And then, so you want this brown, and then I'm gonna come back and show you what we do next. Okay, as you can see, they're getting nice and golden. Now you can put these in the oven or do how I'm gonna do them. And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna basically steam them in the pan with a little drop of water. Okay, so here we go. We're gonna get, you're gonna put this down to a low heat, and you're gonna add a drop of water, and you're gonna put a lid on there. And what this does is it slowly makes its own steam, and it's gonna start cooking some of the inside of your meatballs. So while this is happening, I'm gonna start preparing my my sauce. But like I said, this year is it's a long process. It's not, well, not really that long, a good 15 minutes. By the time you start getting all your sauce ready, you keep doing this, and you're gonna see medium low heat, and you're gonna see that they're gonna start using up its steam. So as you see that there's no more liquid in there, you just lift, and you're just gonna simply add another drop in there. I'll just let them do their thing. So I'm gonna start preparing my sauce. So I'm gonna write down what I put in my sauce. It's a very simple sauce for these meatballs. See how they're cooking? So medium to low heat for this. And you're just gonna let them cook. So I'll see you in a bit, and I'll show you when I throw them into my sauce. Okay, as you can see, they're cooking. They're still not completely cooked, but they're golden. They've swollen up a bit, and they're almost ready to go into the sauce. I'm just finishing my sauce. And like I said, my sauce is a very simple marinara. I'm just making a very fresh tomato sauce. I'm not making something that's gonna be cooking for a long time. And this could be either for subs or a nice pasta. So either way, we're going to enjoy these meatballs, or my family will. And that's it. You're just going to cook them a little longer here while I'm preparing my sauce. It's just a low medium heat that I've got them going. Like I said, if you don't want to do it in the pan with the lid and the water as a steam, you can always put them in the oven. Medium and low heat. Okay guys, you ready? Steak spice. Montreal steak spice. I always add some. And this is also going to add some nice flavors to my sauce. Now, if you are preparing a whole batch and you want to put some in the freezer, this is when you're going to start freezing these after they've been cooked in the pan or in the oven. You could take them, you could throw them in a bag, put them straight in the freezer, and when you need them, you take out what you need, or you can make individual bags, and you have your meatballs ready to throw right into the sauce right out of the freezer. So this is a good time to take them and put them aside, cool them off, and then it goes into the freezer. But yeah, so you can make these ahead of time. And they also got nice and golden. And they're almost ready to go into the sauce. And they really are delicious. just turn them over. Add a little extra water. Give it a sizzle. Cover it and let them do their thing. Just remember, you don't want it too low and you don't want it too high where they just turn black on you. Okay, so here we go. It's a very simple sauce I made. And I'm going to add it now. You see, it's still very liquid. This is when I'm going to add my meatballs. I'm going to add my... There we go. Put it there. Okay, this is where I'm going to add my meatballs to the sauce. And I'm going to lower this to a low simmer. Just like as if we were cooking our roast. When we make our roast or our meat, we don't have a large boil. Otherwise, you're going to have, your meat's going to turn into a sponge. So we're just going to add all the meatballs into this low simmer. And this can cook for at least 60 minutes on a low heat. It's still boiling because I had it on boil, but I will lower this to a very low simmer and just let it do its thing. The meatballs are going to pick up the sauce, the flavors of the tomato, and they're just going to cook right into the sauce. And you know when they're ready in the pan, they start to swell up a little. They're not as squishy. And they have a nice golden color to them. So here we go. They're in. I could actually move my sauce around. So here they are. They're all in the sauce. And that's a nice little piece of hot pepper I put in there because we like it spicy. Or I like it spicy. And now it's going to go into a low simmer. And we're just going to let this cook for 60 minutes. And then just come to check them. They should be... they're not going to break apart on you, and they're just going to do its own little thing. It's going to pick up all the flavors of the sauce, and I'll show you what they look like once they're done. So I'll see you in a bit. Okay, so here we go, guys. I just want to show you. I did cook it for a nice long while. I think it was about a little over 60 minutes. And you see that your sauce is getting thick. You don't want to just keep cooking this because your sauce is going to get thicker and thicker. So I just want to show you what they look like. They're all intact. Ooh, I don't want to lose it. They're all intact. They're nice and big because they do swell up. And I'm just going to bring it over to the plate. And I'm going to show you what it's like when you cut it. So there's the inside of the meatball. It's nice and tender. And it breaks fantastic. You can pick it up with your fork, and it's not that very hard meatball. It's a nice tender meatball, and it stays together in the sauce. So I hope you like this recipe, guys, and if you do, give me a thumbs up, and I'll see you in my next video.